Production funding for Ruckus has been provided by Fred and Lou Hartwig and viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to Ruckus, that weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. I'm Mike Shannon. The Ruckettes join me shortly. Our topics tonight: Union Station at 100, the Kansas City name game over a police station yet unbuilt, and some recent Kansas polls causing Yale to turn pale, plus roast and toast from the panelists. But first, our Ruckus newsmaker, George Costello, CEO at Kansas City's Union Station, set to celebrate its centennial next Thursday, October the 30th. These are heady times for Union Station: cash surpluses, strong attendance figures, responsible tenants, and big plans for the 100th anniversary. To talk about the Union Station from once near extermination to now centennial celebration, we turn to George Costello. George, welcome. It's great to see you again.
Mike, it's good to see you.
Let's talk about the future of Union Station. What's going on next Thursday, October 30th?
Well, what a great time for Kansas City, and more importantly, what a great time for Union Station. It's our 100th anniversary. We start the quintessential celebration of the century. We'll have over 1,500 people at a magnificent gala that's going to help us raise close to $2.5 million for the station, and we'll be making some special announcements for an endowment. Then we start with an opening of a brand new 5,000-square-foot exhibition that tells the complete history of Union Station, and then on November 1st and 2nd, full open houses, fun activity, face painting, and the rededication, so we'll have everyone come back to celebrate Kansas City.
Celebration continues for several days.
Absolutely.
Will it go on all year in some form?
No, we started at Memorial Day, right here on KCPT with the celebration of the station, and honored the troops, and then we'll go right through to this time. So, you know, it's just a quintessential time to say, thank you, Kansas City, it worked.
You and I can both remember a time when failure seemed almost certain at Union Station.
Yeah.
Obviously, that's not the case today. Can you tick off two or three of the key factors that has turned Union Station around?
I think a strong business plan, Mike. When we started almost 6 years ago with our board of directors, we developed a business strategy that made the station sustainable and ensured that we earn almost 98% of our income, no tax dollars. So that was the first strategy. So first, boom, you put in the types of civic organizations such as the Chamber of Commerce, the Kansas City Election
That was
Board.
Major, wasn't it, when those folks moved their offices there?
Absolutely. It was the sustainability. But it allowed us to go back almost 100 years ago to the original strategy: transportation, civic house, a center for celebration. But it has really now become Kansas City's monument. You add then these national and international exhibitions that have helped us maintain the building, such as Diana and Tut and Titanic and America I Am. So it's really a great
Do you
time.
Have to have those on a regular basis to sustain the operations at Union Station?
No, you have those to that type of funds really assist us to maintain the building. Yeah. The sustainable income from the rental allows us to run it on a regular basis, but we don't lose money on those exhibitions. They've had exhibitions like that in the past. Our strategy is if we can't make money on it, we're not going to do it.
Your predecessors, and there were several, always talked about the need for some continuing revenue from a tax stream. I take it now there's no need for a revenue stream provided by tax dollars?
Today we're doing it on our own, and Kansas City has embraced it. We've embraced it by donors of the civic community. When you think a civic community gave almost $100 million 15 years ago. So the first strategy is, no, we stay focused on operating our income. Now, if Kansas City wants to come and the community wants to come and do Bi-State again and build a wing, we'll take
it. By the way, and the panel's going to talk about the history of Union Station in recent years. Bi-State tax is, you know, something that is anathema to a lot of people, or has been, because of what happened at Union Station. But do you think now that it's turned around, people might be more accepting of that concept?
For $117 million 15 years ago, taxpayers on both sides of the state line raised $117 million. I would tell you that was the single best economic development tool in the history of Kansas City. Off a half a billion dollars of development has happened around the station. Union Station is now the success story for Bi-State cooperation. And when you see the numbers of people that come to Union Station, they're coming from all over the metro area, including Kansas. Our largest zip code is Olathe.
If someone hasn't been on Union Station for a while,
shame on them.
Well, shame on them. But can you give us a quick overview of what they will find there?
they'll find Kansas City's monument, a monument to determination and entrepreneurism. They'll find a new and exciting science center with over 80,000 square feet. They'll see the largest digital show projector in the extreme screen. They'll see great restaurants. They'll see civic leaders and mayors on a regular basis. Most importantly, they'll have fun, and they can go back and remember the good times in Kansas City and also celebrate the great times that we're living with right now in Kansas City.
So Science City is not like it was when Union Station reopened in 1999.
You know, Science City was opened as an experiment 15 years ago, and we are a science center. And as a good scientist, you always test the hypothesis. I tell you today that the science center's on a great trajectory. Over $4 million has been invested by companies, and it has an economic strategy. We're opening up two new major exhibitions at Christmas, and the future of almost a $9 million economic development strategy that was going to build the west side of our science center out and change us up.
Next Thursday is the big day for the 100th anniversary of Union Station. Someone wants more information about all the celebrations. Do you have a website?
Absolutely. Unionstation.org. Go on down or go on Facebook and join everybody else. We're so happy that Union Station is back.
All right, sir. Thank you very much for coming in. It's great to see you again. That is George Costello, the CEO at Union Station. Now let's go over and start a ruckus and meet the Ruckettes. Yale Abahaka is an editorial writer at the Kansas City Star. Terry Riley is a former city councilman and now president of Transformation Consultants. Mary O'Halloran is a media and communications consultant. And Slugger Crosby Kemper III is director of the Kansas City Library System and host of KCPT's Meet the Past. Terry, welcome to the program. Crosby, welcome back. And congratulations on the regional Emmy that you and Meet the Past recently won.
Thank you.
That's a nice honor for you and for KCPT. Great. And also thanks to the World Series for not scheduling a game on Thursday evening so Ruckus can have viewers. Let's continue our discussion about Union Station. Once the cause of great controversy and debate, a bi-state sales tax approved across county and state lines in 1996 got the station's renovation underway. But after its opening 3 years later, problems abounded. There were operating deficits, massive layoffs, and a confusing management structure, and there was serious talk of closing the facility. Now it would appear that things have turned around. So what is the lesson the Kansas City area should take from the Union Station turnaround? Let's start with Crosby.
Well, Mike, I was Union Station's banker at those dark year moments, and I can tell you that wasn't the highlight of my banking career. I think the lessons are two. One, you heard George Costello, and George has done a fabulous job. Mike Haverty came in as chairman of the board, Bob Rainier following him, a lot of help from Tom McDonnell and other folks. Senior members of the private sector really got involved. They've turned it around, got great leadership in George. That's lesson number one, is you need great leadership and you need people who are paying attention. And as George said, you need a business plan, you need a business-like plan. Lesson number two is anytime in this city we throw a lot of money at something, the $40 million endowment, the $117 million tax stuff, and we don't pay attention to it, and that's most of the time in Kansas City, you end up with a huge problem. We blew through that $40 million. They should still have a $40 million endowment. I'm on the board. I love what George has done. I love what Mike did. I think he's a key to this, Mike Haverty. But the lesson for Kansas City, and you know, you look at city council voting to spend $1.2 billion before they actually did any analysis of the airport, streetcar. Yale will disagree with me about that, but it's another deal where we haven't done any real analysis. We don't have a real long-term plan. That's the lesson.
All right, Mary, what lesson or lessons from the Union Station turnaround?
Well, I had a couple that I was going to mention, but Crosby usually, as his usual captivating self, has brought up another one, and that is the relationship between the airport. What can learn about the airport question from what has happened at Union Station? From my perspective, I think, look, I love this building. You know, the gravity of its presence in our world, in our community, is immense. In terms of our identity and so on. But look what they did. This building was actually, it was never falling down, but the roof was caving in and it was deteriorating fast. And they took, the people of this region decided that we weren't gonna have that happen. We're gonna repurpose this building, use great planning skills, great architectural skills, and turn this building around and give it back to the people who built it. And I think the people of Kansas City decided it wasn't going to be a success. They could have ditched the plan after it was going bankrupt and so on. But, of course, in Georgia and the others who have made it a center of life in the city deserve credit.
I almost hate to say this, but doesn't Clay Chastain deserve some credit for bringing public attention to Union Station? He was among the first, if not the first.
He was not the first. Sharon Hoffman in a group included me.
Yeah, so. I was about to mention that. I remember when all this came to fruition during, and I like to thank Emmanuel Cleaver and that city council for having a vision at the time to move to repurpose Union Station, first and foremost. Number two, just like George mentioned earlier, this was an experiment. You had the experimental phase, and then you brought the new board on, you brought in the new leadership, and now this place is just a place that Kansas City's proud of. Every time I bring a client to Kansas City, I take them to Union Station because that's something we can be proud of. It's something that's operating in the black. And I think it's a beautiful, majestic building.
Yeah, what about the bi-state tax? As you well know, people don't seem to be excited about that prospect. But now, with all of these vast improvements at Union Station funded initially by a bi-state tax, do you think it could be seriously considered again?
Unfortunately, probably not. I mean, I wish it could be. We're looking back at, it was 18 years ago the first bi-state vote was.
Right.
And yet now we're reaping the benefits. The bi-state tax for arts and the sports stadium renovation was 2004, 10 years ago. Well, if we had let that defeat, which was defeat in Johnson County, 55% to 45%, if we had let that defeat stew and okay, well now let's just forget the stadiums. Well, you know, Crosby wouldn't be wearing his blue today because they more than likely wouldn't be the Kansas City Royals, or there would have been some other cockamamie scheme to somehow move the stadiums or whatever. Eventually, of course, Jackson County taxpayers stepped up in the 2006 vote. The arts still has a possibility of saying, hey, maybe we could do something regionally. But, you know, other than that, there's a trails initiative, things like that, but those are all now kind of being taken care of piecemeal. I wish I could say yes, because I think, you know, to Crosby's point of, well, let's get a good plan, I agree with him. Let's get a good plan for some of these things and try to do them. And yet I think there's so many obstacles now that, you know, it probably won't happen, unfortunately.
Crosby, should Union Station have a dedicated stream of revenue from some sort of tax?
Well, I think at this point they've figured out what Union Station needs is some endowment for the depreciation of the building. It's a huge capital structure, and I think they're in the process of building that. George and Bob Rainier, Mike's still working on it, and I think that'll happen over time. But no, I don't think it needs it at this point.
Does it get any tax support now?
Very little.
Well, but 90% there are governmental units. There are publicly financed. Yeah. Governmental units like the collection.
Paying rent.
Yeah.
Paying rent.
Yeah.
And
but
so
not,
that's
not
a
direct.
Thing.
Yeah, no,
it's a post office.
We forced a lot of folks out of other buildings downtown.
And,
you know,
and God bless the greater Kansas City Chamber of Commerce.
We have to move on. We're going to switch now from the Union Station to the police station and the controversy about what to name it. The yet uncompleted structure is now unofficially called the East Patrol Police Station and Crime Laboratory. But there's a petition campaign underway calling for the new facility to be named for Leon Jordan, a Kansas City civil rights leader who founded Freedom Incorporated with Bruce Watkins. Jordan, a retired Kansas City police lieutenant, was assassinated in 1970 outside the bar he owned. The case remains unsolved. One might think an African-American mayor would find it appealing to honor a local civil rights legend, but Mayor Sly James is reluctant. So, Terry, what is his reasoning?
Well, first and foremost, I've talked with people from the mayor's staff. I've also talked to Councilman Reed. The mayor, based off what I've gathered, was reluctant because none of the stations have been named after any individuals. They're more of regional stations. And that was his reluctance. But now, I know Councilman Reed and the mayor has worked together and put a community group together to come up with a name. And so now the community, the mayor, from my understanding, will do whatever the community wants.
What's your view? What do you think should be done there? Do you think it should be called the Leon Jordan Patrol Division, whatever?
Well, I just don't want to leapfrog over what the community wants in that area. And so, therefore, I will yield.
The mayor says he doesn't want police stations named after people. that in Kansas City, their name for the geographic area they serve, North Patrol, East Patrol, et cetera. Are you saying that he now believes it's okay to name a police station after an individual and not a location?
That was a good question, but I'm still going back to what I said originally.
Well, what was the answer to it?
The answer was the community, they have a community group that they've put together, a panel of people from the community, and they will come up with the name. And whatever name they come up with, I'm pretty sure that the mayor and the city council will embrace
it. Well, Yale, the Star doesn't want to name the Leon Jordan police station, does it?
Well, no, neither does the mayor. I talked directly to the mayor.
I thought he said he was against
it. It was a month ago, and he said exactly what you said. But this whole thing about communities naming anything is fun to think about, theoretically. But at the end of the day, they're owned by the entire city, you know. And I think that, you know, there hasn't been any, one of the things the mayor talked to me is, well, so the Northland's going to, you know, come, you know, the Anita Gorman station or whatever, you know, they're going to come with all these different names and throw them out there when a lot of the names, of course, don't mean that much to people. I mean, a lot of people don't know who, you know, Paseo and all those kind of people are. Warnell and all that kind of stuff. But I think they have a good idea of having you know, part of the building named after either, you know, Jordan or they actually different names came up, you know, Alan Brooks,
Joanne Collins, Benny Moulton.
I mean, all, you know, but then you, you know, do you want to do it in the Northland? Do you want to do it in the West Side?
What do you think, Mary?
I do agree with one of the people that testified. I don't remember who it was before. The commission has had some hearings. Ooh. You know, what's in a name? It's nice to talk about the names and it brings back the history. And God knows Leon Jordan's founding of freedom did change the world for African-American people in Kansas City.
Absolutely.
I don't really care that much. I mean, what I care about is that... is that new building going to do the job? Is the community the community room inside that building going to really be used for the benefit of the people in the neighborhood? Is economic development going to take place around the station to renew the prospect?
Why does naming it stop any of that?
Well, it doesn't stop it, but let's move those issues forward.
You're talking about throwing a lot of money at something without a plan. If I recall correctly, this police station still being built has dramatic cost overruns and some confusion about when it's going to be completed.
Yeah, cost overrun seems to be our middle name, yeah.
So yes. That's an example of what you were discussing
earlier. And I guess it would be an example of what Mary's saying, too. Yeah, we should have paid attention to that stuff, but we're not paying attention.
You seem to be suggesting it's okay to give a building a name, somebody's
absolutely.
Name.
You know, we ought to celebrate our heritage, and most cities do, and we have in many ways. I mean, Bartle, you know, and Kaufman.
Now. Kemper.
Sorry. Well, there's
Truman.
That.
Yeah, there is that.
That may not be a celebration. That to, you know, but you know, let's celebrate these things, and let's know more about our history, and democracy is a little messy.
From a cultural standpoint, and what freedom did at that time, I can understand why people in the community, particularly that lived there in the 3rd District, there was a transformation that occurred politically in the city. There were no committee people. There were no city council members. There were no state reps, state senators. From that, you have mayors. You have congressional members. And so I understand the argument on both sides, but again, if people just knew their history anyway.
Well, we need all right, well, we got libraries and so forth.
We named libraries.
We need to Bluford.
We need to move on.
Okay.
It seems likely our colleague Yale Abuhaka is being ostracized at the Kansas City Star for actually writing of possible GOP victories in Kansas. Despite his strong hopes to the contrary, Yale writes, Republicans have growing reasons to think Governor Sam Brownback is going to defeat Davis and win re-election. And they are giddy over the reversal in the Senate race, where incumbent Pat Roberts could slip by Orman. Yale, how did you arrive at this judgment? And number two, how lonely are you?
Well, I guess we'll see on Election Day, actually. No, two things. One, the polls have turned around. They are going, swinging back basically more to, hey, we're in a red state and we're going to elect Republicans here. And so that's where Roberts and obviously Brownback get their swag. And the second thing is the campaign's run by Paul Davis and Greg Orman. They haven't been that exciting. It's one of those things where Orman running as an independent doesn't have that whole, you know, Democratic apparatus working behind him. He has basically himself and his idea that
he doesn't have the ground game.
Yeah, send somebody to Congress who's not going to play the old games. Well, that's appealing to a portion of people, but on the other hand, you know, with you have Roberts bringing in all these outsiders, you know, who still have name cachet, especially in deep red parts of the state, not necessarily in Johnson County, but in other parts of the state, Dole and, you know, Palin. Well,
and earlier today, Bill Graves, I believe, former governor,
Bill Graves endorsed him, which is unbelievable. But I think for Brownback is obviously he's running. Yeah, I mean, you know, my colleague Barb Shelley last week called him a liar, and he is. But it's one of those things where
who a liar?
Brownback, yeah, okay. A liar, and he is. But I think one of the things he's able to do, one of the things he's able to do is on the campaign trail say, hey, I've been the governor, I'm doing something radical, and I'll give it time to work. Yeah. And I think a lot of Kansans, Republicans especially, are willing to do that. So we'll see what happens.
I want to go to Crosby here. I heard one analyst talking about what was likely to happen in Kansas, and he thought that Roberts would win, and he called it Kansans' muscle memory. The fact that reflexively Kansans are accustomed to voting Republican.
I also think there's been this hype, and the Stars participated in the media generally have hyped the Orman as an independent. What Orman is an opportunist. Yeah. I mean, he announced that he was going to caucus with whoever is the majority. Now, there's a principle to really wrap your arms around. And, I think it is the muscle memory of Kansans. I think there's a Republican wave. It's not a tsunami, but it's a Republican wave. The Senate's going to go Republican. I think Kansas is going to be Republican. Brownback will win, and Roberts will win. It's also, the attack on Roberts has been he hasn't been in favor of Kansas, and he's 78, and he lives in Washington, D.C., which is not much of a campaign.
That's putting it very, very mildly. It's always easy to go with how the state has always been. What is remarkable about this, Yale, and what you're missing is the energy and commitment of people who said, we don't have to have Brownback's radical fiscal policies in place for another 4 years. It is not required of the people of Kansas to keep electing Pat Roberts and sending him there for 47 years.
A man part of that said, time, you know, he wasn't an elected official.
Know,
he
but he's
served
been
in
there
Bob
for
Dole's
47
office.
Years. That's not required.
Terry, polls seem to be, and not just here, but around the country, people can't decide. I mean, they're up and they're down, and this guy's ahead and then he's behind. And some people think it's because the public is strongly dissatisfied with both political parties.
They are. And that's where the appeal comes with Orman. But he's gotten more specific as to what he would like to accomplish. If you look at CNN polls, the new CNN poll that just came out, and you look at Real Clear's poll that just came out, it will show you there are about 4.7% of the people sitting on the sideline, and they're waiting. And in the ground game you're talking about with Orban's campaign, the ground game's coming. The ground game is happening right now. As they speak, but he will also benefit, Ortman will benefit from the ground game of Davis.
And he will benefit from the fact that he's a successful businessman from Olathe.
Yes.
Pat Roberts did not carry Johnson County in the Republican primary.
All right.
I don't think there will be a wave.
If this independent, there will be a
Monmouth
wave.
Monmouth College.
Here's the only wave you're going to see in this. It is time now. Time now for Roast and Toast, where the Ruckheads offer a pat on the back or a kick in the pants to people and events making news. And we start with Crosby.
So I'd like to toast Frank White and Joyce D. Donato for being class act. And I would like to suggest to the Royals that they have Joyce throw out the first ball on opening day next year and Frank sing the national anthem.
Well, I'll stay with Brownback because I think his latest race baiting ad on the Carr brothers or black people killed somebody, and he's basically implying that the Kansas Supreme Court let them free and Paul Davis will let that happen. Not true at all. Basically, Kansas Supreme Court said, no, they're going to stay in jail, but the death penalty part of it was improperly done. Brownback knows that. He lies about it, and I hope I'm wrong, and I hope the people of Kansas reject his philosophy, and we'll see. But shame on Sam Brownback.
Oh, I'm so happy to be able to be on this week and to toast Gene Schodorf. Nobody has talked about the Secretary of Race. In
Secretary of State race.
Oh. On the show recently, because we talked about Kobach and how disastrous he's been, and his two-tier voting system for people in voter suppression efforts. Gene Schodorf, on the other hand, has carried on this quiet, old-fashioned race for Secretary of State. She is a remarkably competent woman with a PhD, many years in the, as a Republican state senator, and she will do the job that he has refused to do on a full-time basis.
I will go ahead and toast a local city council member by the name of Jermaine Reed. Early on in Jermaine Reed's term, as y'all know, it's a little bumpy getting to know the terrain. But ever since this young man's been in office, there's been over $200 million worth of investment in the 3rd District, and that's unheard of in Kansas City. So I toast Jermaine Reed, city council member of Kansas City.
All right, finally, I'm going to offer a mild roast to Hillary Clinton, who can't seem to overcome tone deafness. Once again, she charged a six-figure fee to speak at an institution of higher learning, this time a fundraiser for UNLV. Her fee, $225,000, and her topic, the high cost of higher education. We got just a few extra seconds, 15 or 20. What's ahead on Meet the Past? What's coming up?
Well,
who's coming up?
You're going to see part of the Union Station celebration, an interview with Ernest Hemingway, whose beat when he worked for the Kansas City Star, his first job was Union Station, Hospital Hill, and Police Station Number 5. I think that'll be a lot of
fun.
And
it's coming up on KCPT, I think, in early November.
You bet.
All right, that is Ruckus for this week. We're back next Thursday at 7 o'clock. Our guest panelist will be Steve Rose and Pat McInerney. Now, thank you very much for watching. On behalf of all the Ruckettes and the Ruckus crew, good night.